Hey there folks, this is GreenyXI, welcoming you right back to Let's Play Umineko. This is episode 7. I want to give a warning before we get started today. I do have a bit of a cold, which is not preferable, but all it means is that I might have the odd 5-minute break now and again, but, you know, it'll be cut out and all that, so it shouldn't make any difference. Anyway, in the last episode, we saw that the adults were all struggling with their businesses, except for Kraus, who they're trying to sort of get their money out of because they think he's stolen the gold, the reward gold. And we also saw, we saw the epitaph and the actual riddle that they have to solve in order to get the family gold out of their grandfather, or their father, and, you know. Anyways, the kids said they were all going down to the beach, so here they are, and let's get going. It looks like they're going to try and solve the riddle themselves as well. Even the staff can try. So, on a tenth twilight, the journey ends, and you reach the golden land. You really are diligent, Maria. You did a good job writing it this all down. Ooh. I forget a lot, so I always write things down. Mama told me to. It's a good idea. Smart. There's a notebook inside the handbag Maria was always carrying around, and Beatrice's epitaph was copied onto it. Thanks to that, we were all able to challenge the puzzle of the epitaph while walking down this beach. Jessica and the rest had already tried to solve it several times, and had already gotten bored with it. However, since this was a first for me, I was so excited that I couldn't stop. It really tickled my sense of adventure. Let's start with the first line. Behold the Sweetfish River, running through my beloved hometown. Where was Grandfather's hometown again? I heard that before the war, the Shiromaya family had a mansion near Odawara. Which makes you want to know which Sweetfish River flows through Odawara, right? I'm probably butchering that name. Yeah, because that river would be the starting place. Anyone searching for the Golden Land would head down that and search for the key. What's this river in Odawara? Does it have sweetfish swimming in it? If you're looking for sweetfish in Odawara, it'd be Hayakawa. It's famous for its mountain stream fishing. Ooh, I hate fish. Maria, you'll understand when you get a bit older. Lick, 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 salty roasted sweetfish. Yummy. Even though we just ate, I'm getting hungry again. Shall I bring you a biscuit? Huh? Oh, sorry, that's not what I meant. Don't mind it. Shannon Chan was faithfully keeping us company since she didn't have any afternoon chores for a while. I would have thought that since she's a servant, accompanying us would force her to take care of us and tire her out, but that didn't seem to be the case for her. On the contrary, she seemed to enjoy joining in on a conversation with people close to her age. When I asked, I heard that she was the sort of worker whose room and board were supplied by her employer. So normally, the only person close to her in age was Jessica. Yeah, I can imagine how that might be pretty dull. Good. Okay, so I get that the Sweetfish River near Odawara is Hayakawa. Let me sneeze. Okay. In that case, we gotta go down it. Do you find anything if you head down the Hayakawa River? If you follow it downstream, you'll arrive at the ocean. Of course, you'd reach the mouth of the river. And the third line of the epitaph was, as you travel down it, you'll see a village. By the way, since long ago, the mouths of rivers have been key points in transportation, and large cities tend to be built there. That'd be the next checkpoint. That's a pretty good theory. Just like you guessed, there's an old city there that was very prosperous in ancient times. That's where Odawara Castle is. I think I might have gone to Odawara Castle on a field trip once. It really was a wonderful castle. Yeah, I also went there. Even though I live in a Western-style house, it's true the Japanese people feel calmer with a Japanese layout. Ooh, castles are boring. Theme parks are better. I agree. I like both. I see. Okay. If we find the gold, the Great Battler's Hammer will generously reserve a whole theme park for a day and let you play in it. Still, Odawara Castle, huh? The hidden gold of Odawara Castle. Ho-ho. It's actually starting to sound pretty good. Well, we figured out that much 2 years ago. The village down the river where the sweetfish swim in Odawara. We figured it was probably somewhere near Odawara Castle. The problem is the next line. Okay, let's see where Battler's strange reasoning can take him. Jessica grinned broadly. She seemed to be implying that she would have solved the puzzle long ago if it was that easy. Damn it. I'll definitely find it and keep it all for myself. The fourth line. In that village, look for the shore the two will tell you of. I don't know what it means by the two, but anyway, the shore. What's it mean by the shore? No, wait. Is there any place near there with shore or kishi in its name? I've heard there's a place called Sogakishi in Odawara. Huh? Wow, you sure know a lot about it. What could that mean? Shannon-chan, you trying to solve the riddle and get the gold too? That makes us rivals. It's not like I'm interested in gold. It's just that George-sama told me about it before. That's because we reached the same conclusion 2 years ago. We even went to the trouble of laying out a map and looking it up. It's about 5 kilometers to the north of Odawara. We definitely found a place called Sokakishi there. However, after that we get stuck. The fifth line doesn't say where the key is hidden in that place. Maria-chan, could you read it for us? No. There sleeps the key to the Golden Land. Oh. I could read it. Sokakishi is probably large, and there wasn't ever any house built there by the Ashuramaya family. Not much we can do to find a key in such a vast area without any hints. You're right. And without the key, we can't advance to the next line. Jojoniki, what kind of place is Sokakishi? Let's see. I've never been there, so I don't really know, but according to the map, it's in the mountains. I'm pretty sure it was at the base of Mount Asama. Something doesn't feel right. You'd expect a riddle pointing the way to hidden gold to be a bit more exact. I get the feeling that even the part about Sogakishi was a mistake. Well, I think it could be Sogakishi. It could be talking about some house the grandfather lived in when he was a kid that we don't know about. After all, the first line mentioned his beloved hometown. Shannon, you've served grandfather alcohol and stuff lots of times, right? Hasn't he ever talked to you about his past? The master almost never speaks of the past. However, he talks of the Great Kanto Earthquake as though it was someone else's story. So he may have been living far away from the Kanto area. The Shiromaya family may have been living in Odawara, but not all the branch families were. Grandfather often called himself part of a branch or a branch family, the least connected to the successor. That means the beloved hometown might not be in Odawara at all. I've never heard anything about grandfather's hometown, and I doubt he'd actually tell me if I asked. If the so-called beloved hometown isn't referring to the Shiromaya family's roots, then Odawara theory is wrong from the beginning. Of course, if this doesn't completely remove the possibility that it was Sokakishi. For example, perhaps he lived in Odawara when he was very young, but then moved far away later. Don't understand what you're all talking about. Maria had been completely left out of the conversation, and she now sat puffing out her cheeks in boredom. So basically, if we can't even agree on the starting point for this dice game of gold, we're totally stuck. But wait, after the first 5 lines, the thing we end up finding is a key, right? Even if you don't have a key, it's always possible to bust through a door. Can't we just skip the first 5 lines and start figuring out the rest? I hadn't thought of that. Oh well, we're just wasting time anyway. Let's hear the rest of Battler's reasoning. But in the next part, it gets dark really fast. Shannon-chan frowned slightly. After looking back at Maria's notebook to recall what was written there, I was forced to agree. On the first twilight, offer the 6 chosen by the key of sacrifices. It sure does get horrible quickly. On the second twilight, it says to tear apart the two who are close. Does that mean to make them break off their loving relationship? Or does it mean to literally tear them apart? I don't know, but either way, it's pretty disgusting. Even if we set that second line aside, it mentions 6 people for the first twilight, then 5 people for the 4th through 8 twilights. So at least 11 people must be sacrificed. They sacrificed to revive Beatrice. I see, sacrifices to restore the witch. Yeah, that's what it would mean. Near the end, the witch will be revived on the 9th twilight. That last part is guaranteed. On the 9th twilight, the witch shall revive, and none shall be left alive. So everyone will die in the end. And after that, the 10th twilight is the goal line. Not sure how you're supposed to reach the Golden Land if everyone's dead by then. Depending how you interpret it, the traveller who holds the key may or may not be included in the none shall be left alive part. But at the end, there's something pretty interesting. After reaching the goal, the witch gives out 4 treasures. One shall be all the gold. The problem is the next one. It says the dead souls will be resurrected, right? Doesn't that sound like it means everyone who died in the earlier lines? If you put it like that, then the part about reviving lost love might refer to the pair torn apart on the second twilight. That's right. And the fourth one refers to the ninth twilight. The fourth treasure is putting the witch, revived on the ninth twilight, to sleep. If we put a happy spin on all this, it'll be hectic with people dying and breaking up all over the place, but it'll be all made right in the end. The awakened witch will sleep again, and everything will be like it was at the start, except with a huge pile of gold. The witch must be pretty busy with what with all the killing, reviving, breaking up, reuniting people. Not to mention waking up and sleeping. Jeez, just when the tale of the hidden gold was getting interesting, it all gets pretty dubious once the witch starts showing up. Too true. I laughed along with Jessica. After all, the idea of a witch was just too ridiculous. Of course, once we started laughing like that, Maria, who believed in the witch, got angry. Here we go. Oh, the witch is incredible. She can do anything with magic. Even kill. Even bring back to life. Even give love. Even take it. She can fly in the sky, can become invisible, can even make gold and bread out of nothing. Ugh, dang. My bad, we were just joking. See, this is why I like Maria. She has that spin on the story where witches are completely real, and only her and grandfather sort of understand that side of things, I think. Jessica apologised, sticking out her tongue, but Maria didn't accept it. She grabbed her notebook back out of my hands and, opening to some other pages, tried to prove that the witch existed. Those pages had colourful drawings of witches on them, and well conveyed the fantastical image Maria had of witches. It wasn't a normal sinister image of a crooked-nosed hag flying around on a broomstick, but a dreamlike person with unnatural powers who could do anything and wore a beautiful dress. It was just what you'd expect from an imaginative young girl. Flitting through the sky, crossing a rainbow, dancing around all night with a teacup and a teapot that would never get empty no matter how much you poured out of it. With a flourish of her staff, the stars in the sky would become candy and pour down, and flowers that produced sweets would bud by the roadside. To Maria, witches were the only concept that could embody the magical dream that so captivated her. As she grew older, it was the last remaining thing that could give richness to her dull and plain, everyday life. Does he mean older as in up to the age she is now, or even older? That's why Maria believed in witches. She didn't want that dream of hers to be tarnished. That's why she didn't want anyone to tarnish the epitaph, which affirmed the existence of witches. Because the witch named Beatrice is Maria's dream. To Maria Chan, the epitaph isn't a guide to the hidden gold, but magic to revive the witch. So it was the single link between Maria and the witch. Maria was very angry and clung to George and Nikki. Jessica and I scratched our heads and apologised. It might not be possible to smooth things over again, like the time she got mad in front of the portrait. Maria didn't seem willing to be easily consoled. Unlike Jessica and I, who hung our heads wondering what to do, Shannon Chan timidly opened her mouth. Maria Sama, did you know? There's a ghost story about Beatrice that has been passed down amongst the servants. That's how they say it in the anime, Beatrice. Ooh? Ah, yeah, that's right. Shannon, tell us about it. I don't really know, but it's apparently pretty famous among the servants. Was it this? A ghost story? Yes. It seems it's a story from before we were born. I also heard about it from my mother. Yes, it's been passed down since the time of the mansion's construction. The servants of that time whispered that the mansion had two masters, one of the day, one of the night. The tale that Shannon told was just like a typical campfire ghost story. If there was a forest with a witch living inside it, then of course the witch would come pay the mansion a visit from time to time. At some point, the ghost story naturally sprouted up between the servants. When people do the rounds a second time to check doors, windows, locks that were supposedly closed, they'd find some of them left open. Lights that were supposed to be off were turned on, and lights that were supposed to be on went out. Things left lying around would disappear, and things would appear when no one had any memory of putting them there. When any of these things happened, the old servants would say that the witch had visited the mansion, invisible, playing pranks. Ooh. See, she exists. Beatrice exists. Yeah, she exists. Long ago, it was always right before leaving for school that I wasn't able to find my bag and stuff. Maria puffed out her chest with an ooh, ooh, as though this was final proof of the witch's existence. If I opened my mouth, Maria would probably be hurt again, so I didn't. I mean, you hear this kind of story everywhere. Depending on the place, they might blame it on a dwarf or an elf. The only difference is that they call it the witch on this island. Of course, walking around a vast, elegant mansion at night would be little unsettling. It's an island devoid of people. Since the mansion's so drafty, walking around on the night of a thunderstorm would certainly be eerie. Oh, I'd love to try it. In addition, some servants have also seen will-o'-the-wisps and glittering butterflies dancing round. Cannon-kun also saw something like that when he was patrolling one night. And recently, you often hear servants talking about strange footsteps heard inside the mansion near midnight. You see the mention of butterflies? You see a lot of golden butterflies in the anime whenever witches are mentioned. It's that sort of style. We've whispered together that the Beatrice-sama in the portrait sometimes makes herself invisible and walks through the mansion. It happened a while ago, but even I heard footsteps while patrolling at night that resemble these stories. Whew. That's scary. But there's nothing to be afraid of. Beatrice-sama is another ruler of this mansion, separate from the master, so there's no need to be unnaturally afraid. If you respect her, I hear she won't do anything bad. However, she can be quite terrifying if you don't respect her, right? Correct. I've heard that just before I began working here, someone who spoke badly about Beatrice-sama fell down the stairs and quit after receiving a large injury to their back. Because of that, there was a rumour between the servants that Beatrice-sama's anger had been brought down upon this person. Oh, anger will definitely be brought down on Battler and Jessica. Oh, I'm sorry. I don't want her anger brought down upon me. I apologise, Maria. Of course, I also apologise to the witch. I'm sorry, Beatrice-sama. Please forgive an outsider's nonsense. I'll apologise as well. I'm sorry, Beatrice-sama. Will the witch be able to forgive us now? Oh, dunno. Witches are fickle, so they forgive when they want to, and don't when they don't. Oh, that's no good. Maria-chan, isn't there some kind of good luck charm that could prevent Battler-kun and Jessica-chan from suffering Beatrice-sama's wrath? Maybe something that can block against magic? By relying on Maria, who was proud of knowing the most about witches, George was trying to revive her self-esteem. Once again, I gotta admire his ability to calm kids down. After taking a moment to cross her arms and seriously ponder whether there might be a charm that could save us, she started flipping through the pages in her notebook. I thought it was just a scribbled diary, but there also seemed to be quite a few pages that looked like they'd come from a book on black magic. Maria solemnly considered a group of these pages, which contained things that looked like magic circles. Apparently, Grandfather wasn't the only one with a black magic hobby. When Maria finally found what she was looking for, she snapped the notebook shut and threw it into her handbag. She then began fishing through that bag's contents. There seemed to be various jumbled up things in there. After a while, she took out various pieces of junk, although they were probably important magical items to Maria, and repeatedly threw them back in, saying they were wrong. It was all a little humorous, just like when Doraemon took out the wrong tool. What's that referring to? That's got to be a big anime reference or something, haven't it? Finally, she seemed to discover what she was looking for. With a face that was unimaginably cheery when compared to the intense expression she had worn until now, she held those out to Jessica and me. Ooh. I grabbed it and saw that it was a very cheap looking charm. It looked like a bracelet made from a plastic rosary, with a scorpion themed medal attached. Haven't you ever seen those cheap zodiac themed accessories? I think I know what they're on about actually, I think I have seen them. The kind you might win in the crane game at an arcade, yeah. Really looked like something like that. There were two of them. Probably one for me, one for Jessica. However, the very fact that there were two of them made them feel even more like cheap manufactured goods, making it pretty hard to think of them as magical items. You're giving these to me and Battler? Oh. With these charms, you don't even need to worry about Beatrice, because scorpions have the power to ward off magic. Huh? Really? Didn't know scorpions could do that. Oh, Battler doesn't believe. He didn't say he didn't believe. I said too much and angered Maria again. Maria took out her notebook again, pointing out various pages as she went on and on about the scorpion. How it had such incredible holy power that it had been used in magic-repelling magical circles since ancient times. I've heard about that from some of the other young servants. Something about how the scorpion is drawn as a magic-repelling symbol in sorcery. Hmm, really? Ooh, the scorpion protects against bad magic and calamity. An emerald brings peace to the heart. Therefore, its effects are twofold. Ooh, It's true. The scorpion wraps around the emerald and protects it. Yes, that certainly does sound like it'd work well. I really wanted to make fun of those worthless looking charms, but as I watched Maria explain them with all of her heart, and realised that she found them for our sakes, I started to feel like it might actually work, even if it was just a prize from some game centre. The material quality of the charm didn't matter. What mattered was the strength of her feelings. Even I don't think of myself as the sort of loser who'd laugh at something like that. Okay, thank you. I apologise to Beatrice Summer, but even if I do end up getting cursed, I'll be safe now thanks to Maria's charm. Right, Jessica? Yeah, that's right. Thanks, Maria. Aww. Wear it on your arm when you want your heart to be at peace. Put it in your wallet and your money won't decrease. Oh, maybe the adults should be trying this. If you hang it from a doorknob, bad things can't get in. It's a really convenient charm. What an incredible effect. If Maria-sama gives it her confident seal of approval, it surely must be reliable. Shannon-chan clapped her hands together, and Maria stuck out her chest. She was totally in a good mood again. It's probably best if we let her lead the conversation a bit longer, if it'll keep her in such a good mood. Come to think of it, she looked a bit bored when we were getting excited about the hidden gold, probably because she couldn't keep up. While eating the cookies Kumasawa-san had baked, Jessica and I asked Maria this and that about black magic. Maria happily chatted away in response to our questions. Each time, Jojiniki and Shannon-chan would act surprised or chime in. The clouds in the sky grew darker and darker, but we cousins really enjoyed communicating freely after a year of separation. It's nice to let the youngest of the group just have their fun. Did I just feel a drop on my forehead? I wonder. As Jojiniki rubbed his forehead, he looked up at the sky. Considering the colour of the sky and the dampness of the air, it wouldn't have been odd for a raindrop to hit him. The wind also seemed to have grown a bit stronger. I didn't feel a drop. Only I didn't. Don't worry, neither did I. Anyway, I'm sure it'll rain so much tonight that everyone will get to feel plenty of raindrops. That's right. Maybe we should head back soon. Shannon-chan looked down at their watch. It was probably well into the evening by now. Is it already time for you to return to your work? Yes. Thank you very much for allowing me to enjoy some time together with you all. Tell Kumasawa-san thanks for the cookies. Okay, everyone, help out with the cleanup. Shannon-chan declined our help, saying that this was a servant's job. But picking up dropped forks before the waitress has to is pretty much my purpose in life. He said, gentlemen. We folded up the blanket, gathered up the trash, and helped clean everything up. Oh, the trash is getting away. I won't let it escape. I'll grab it before Maria does.
Oh,
I'll grab it.
Oh.
Maria, don't get your shoes wet. You'll get in trouble. To Maria, chasing after some trash sent flying by the powerful winds was just another game. By the time we finished, the wind was blowing pretty strongly. Oh, just random, but I love how Maria has such interesting clothes and everything because her mother, Rosa, is in the fashion line business. So it makes sense. Probably a good time to head back. You've all helped me out a lot. Thank you very much. It looks like you're really out of time. It's okay if you head back first. Jojiniki perceived from her hurried appearance that very little of her free time was left. Genji-sen's very strict about time. If you don't show up where you're supposed to be at the right time, I bet he'll be pissed. We'll see you later. Do your best with your work. Yes. Then if you'll excuse me. After making a respectful bow, Shannon-chan ran towards the rose garden. Okay, let's head back to the guest house. We can watch TV or something, and relax a little. Ooh, wanna watch TV? Wanna watch TV? Ooh. Don't we all? Then it's decided. Let's all head back and watch TV together. Maria, who wasn't done having fun, agreed once television was mentioned. We climbed up the gentle stairs and returned to the rose garden. All the way up. The wind had grown very strong, and roses shook throughout the garden like ripples on water. This might be our last chance to see these beautiful roses. I'll bet tonight's typhoon ruins them. These roses might be done in by tonight's winds. You're right. Still, I think the roses were pretty lucky. After all, they got to welcome all of you before the typhoon. All flowers lose their petals eventually, but that means we can admire them even more when they're in bloom. Okay, give me 2 seconds. I need to stop a sec. Okay, I'm back. That's right. Maria, burn this image into your eyes. At this moment, they are the best roses of the year.
Oh my god, I literally just came back and I got a sneeze. Oh, there we go.
Ooh, burned into eyes. Right then, Maria suddenly clapped her hands. It looked like she'd remembered something. My rose! Oh yeah, they tied something to the rose. The typhoon will send it flying. Ooh, there's something strange about this, the tied rose. I love the image of it and the idea of it for some reason in this game. It's something that's really memorable. Oh, you mean that sad-looking rose Georginiki marked with a ribbon? Maria apparently remembered where the rose was. She ran at full speed. The rest of us followed her. Oh? Where was that again? I'm sure it was somewhere around here. We searched everywhere around that area, but it was only a single flower among all of these roses, after all. Even though we knew it was somewhere close by, we weren't able to find it. The winds making up the typhoon's front lines made roses throughout the garden undulate. It was almost like it was teasing us by making the location of Maria's rose impossible to find. Maybe it wasn't here. Let's try spreading out a bit in our search. Sounds good. Let's go for strength in numbers. What's up, Maria? As we made to split up and search, Maria tugged on my jacket with an unhappy face. You could tell that she didn't want us to leave that spot. What is it? What's wrong? Oh, my rose is here. It's here. But it's actually not, right? Maybe it was on the other side of the flower bed. If we all look, we'll find it fast, okay? Oh, it's here. My rose is here. Look for it. Look for it. Oh. Maria stomped her feet in irritation. She pointed at that spot and said it was definitely there, but in actuality, it wasn't. Even so, Maria got mad when we said we were going to search elsewhere. We were at a loss for what to do. For a while, we had to stay near Maria and pretend to search through that rose thicket. Maria's showing a sort of spoiled attitude that comes up with all kids, you know, younger kids. They all go through it. Oh, oh, not here, not here, not here, oh. Maybe she's saying that it should be here but isn't. Maria became increasingly irritated. Oh man, Maria's really losing her temper. Sometimes Maria starts to really care about really pointless stuff. If she gets what she wants, that's okay, but... You can't find something that isn't there. That's not good. Just when we were at a loss of what to do, Maria called out in a loud voice. Mama! Oh! We could see Aunt Rosa in the direction Maria was waving her hand. Maybe she wanted to look at the garden one more time before the typhoon came. Or maybe she had some business at the guest house. Aunt Rosa was coming from the mansion. She quickly noticed her daughter's voice and came over. My, my, what happened, everyone? You looking for something? Look for it. Mama, you look for my rose too. Ooh. Your rose? We found an unhealthy rose around here and marked it. We tied a candy wrapper around it. But Maria, if I remember correctly, it was growing right in front and really stood out, didn't it? Unless it grew legs and ran off somewhere, it must have been somewhere else. Maybe you remembered it wrong. Oh, it's here. It is here. Battler doesn't believe. Oh. How many times do I have to tell you to stop saying oh before you'll understand? Mama will look for it, so stay quiet. I'd never seen Aunt Rosa be anything other than kind and gentle, so her anger surprised me a bit. Aunt Rosa began searching as well, so we went along with her for the time being. But we were already more than sure that it wasn't around here. So it didn't take long for Aunt Rosa to realise that too. The rose isn't here. Did you mistake this place for somewhere else? There's so many roses around. Oh, oh, that's wrong. It's here. Mama doesn't believe. Ooh. I already believed you and looked hard for it, didn't I? But it isn't here. Oh, but it is here. It is here, but it isn't. Oh. Then someone must have ripped it out. Anyway, stop saying ooh. 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 Who ripped out my rose? Who did? Give it back, give it back. Oh. Oh. How should I know? Stop it, stop saying ooh. Aunt Rosa slapped Maria's left cheek with her palm. In that instant, Maria was shocked into silence. Of course, it was only for an instant. When Maria realised that her wish was being rejected, she started yelling even louder. Oh, oh, my rose, My rose. Didn't I tell you to stop that weird habit? That's why all the kids in the class make fun of you. Cut it out.
Once again, her palm slapped Maria's cheek. This time she didn't go silent. She choked as she started crying and began to bawl in an increasingly loud voice.
Aunt Rosa was clearly irritated and lifted her hand once more to try and shut her daughter up. Aunt Rosa. No, she's just a little kid, so there's no reason to get so serious.
I tried to cut in with a bitter smile, rubbing my hands together. But Aunt Rosa glared at me with a serious face, and I realised that I should have stayed out of this. I'm sorry, but could the rest of you go back to your room for a bit? I need to have a little talk with Maria.
Oh, nobody believes in my rose, even though it was here. Oh, look for it. Look for it. Here, it was here. Oh.
But it's not here. So you must have confused this place for somewhere else, right?
Oh, it is here. It's definitely here. Oh.
Then it disappeared. Give it up.
Why? Why did it disappear? Why? Oh, I don't know that. So stop saying ooh.
Aunt Rosa once again raised her hand, overcome by emotion, and slapped Maria's cheek.
It was strong enough to knock Maria over. Hey, Aunt Rosa, even if she is your daughter, violence isn't the answer.
I stepped between them to protect Maria, who was still on the ground crying ooh.
I knew that, as an outsider, problems between parent and child were none of my business.
But I wasn't brought up to just silently observe something like this.
Don't you think it's weird, Batlakun? Are there any girls at your school who mutter ooh?
Well, I'm in high school. But for an elementary school, I think saying ooh is pretty cute.
Cute? Saying ooh is cute?
Cute? My careless words seemed to have earned me Aunt Rosa's wrath. She grabbed my collar with a terrifying expression.
Don't say such nonsense. Do you know how old Maria is? She's 9. She's a 4th grader. Not a kindergartner. But she still makes that sound during class.
Don't you get it? Do you know what they say about this kid when they bully her? Thanks to this weird habit, she still hasn't made a single friend.
Don't turn your eyes from reality and carelessly call Maria cute.
Think more seriously about this kid's future.
I told you, stop making that sound. Didn't I tell you to stop it?
Aunt Rosa struck Maria's quivering head, from which an increasingly unhappy voice was rising. I tried to stop it, but Aunt Rosa pushed me away. My back hit Georginiki. A long time ago, Aunt Rosa also thought of it as nothing more than one of Maria Chan's baby words.
But now that it hasn't been fixed even midway through elementary school, she's been worrying about it a lot.
How she talks isn't really that big of a deal, right? She'll never make it as an adult if she's like that. So even though it isn't fun to watch, this is a problem between parent and child.
Well,
even I get chewed out by Mom all the time because of how I talk. When they put it that way, maybe even a scene as painful as this isn't something an outsider like me should butt in on.
Batlakun, when you were a kid, didn't you have any bad habits that you couldn't fix and that got you into trouble?
Well, one or two. On Parents' Day once, I kept getting yelled at in front of everyone, and it was embarrassing as all hell.
Well then, you can understand how the two of them must feel right now.
I'm sure they don't want us to be here now. You understand too, don't you, Jessica-chan?
I don't think anyone likes to be seen when they're being scolded.
Let's go. We'll return to the guest house. Then, after Maria-chan comes back, let's welcome her as if nothing happened.
That's probably for the best, isn't it?
We thought Georginiki's point was probably a reasonable one, and we may have been eager to use that reasonable sounding argument as a justification to retreat from this heart-rending scene. Jessica and I nodded at Georginiki, and we all left. We called towards Maria, telling her that we were going to head to the guest house. But she didn't seem to hear. We felt sort of guilty and shameless after saying it.
In that case, look by yourself as much as you want. Mama doesn't care.
Oh, I'll look for it. I'll look for it by myself. Even if Mama doesn't care.
Oh.
Have it your way. After blasting her with those last few words, Rosa spun on her heels and quickly returned to the mansion. Maria probably viewed that as a cold gesture meant to injure. But that wasn't Rosa's intention. It was because the hand with which she had so emotionally struck Maria's cheek was still numb. It was because if she stayed there screaming, she might again be taken over by her emotions and continue slapping her daughter's cheek over and over. After Rosa left, Maria was left alone in the rose garden. The wind began to blow stronger and stronger, and every once in a while, a raindrop would fall on her forehead. However, Maria couldn't leave that place. Not until she found that poor, wilting rose. It had definitely been there. Even so, it wasn't. Even though she knew the place, and even though it had been there, it wasn't. Maria bitterly stared at the place it was supposed to be, and thought frantically. Maybe the angle I'm looking from is wrong. Maybe the height I'm looking from is wrong. While gazing at a single point, Maria repeatedly stood up, changed her position, and continued to stare. The wind was getting stronger and stronger, but Maria kept on looking for that rose in front of the flower bed. Here comes the rain. Kinzo noticed the sound of the raindrops beating on the window. It seemed to be pouring down thickly. It had begun to rain later than the weather report had predicted. Kinzo approached the window as if being summoned by the sound of the rain. The sound of rain is a sound of silence. That sound feels quieter than any silence. It makes humans remember that, in the end, they are alone from the moment they're born to the moment they die. "You're late, Beatrice." Were those words directed at the rainy sky? There were no one to be seen in the direction of Kinzo's gaze. "Well then, let's begin. Let us begin our banquet of miracles. This island has now been cut off from the world, Storm. Now there are none who can interrupt my ceremony. There are many fitting sacrifices for you. 4 of my children, 3 of their companions, 4 of my grandchildren, me and my guests and my servants. You may devour as many as you please. The key of fate will select the sacrifices in accordance with the demon's roulette. If that roulette chooses me, even I will become your sacrifice. However, because of that, because I will bet on such madness, I will most assuredly bring forth a grand miracle. Come, devour to your heart's content. I will achieve victory over that roulette. Yes, I'll put everything on the line. First, I'll return the inheritance of the Ashuramaya family. Accept it." Kinzo tore the window open, ripped the golden ring off his finger, and forcefully threw it away. At that time, the sound of thunder rang out, giving the illusion that the lightning had accepted the ring. "And, when you are resurrected, surely I will be the one who stands witness. I will survive until the end and watch over you as you awaken. So come, Beatrice. Welcome to my banquet. In exchange for all that I have created, show me another miracle just this once." "Oh, Beatrice." And here we go. We got the storm. We've had an amazing scene. Possibly my favourite scene of the game. Where are we going to now? 6 o'clock? 6 o'clock. Nice. But yeah, possibly one of my most memorable scenes of the game. The Rose Garden with Rosa and Maria. Showing their relationship a little bit. But only because I think Rosa's stressing a little bit about her daughter's how it's going to go on as she goes into adulthood and all that. And, yeah, their relationship's one of my favourites in the game, to be fair. Anyways, that's it. This has been Greeny XI. I hope you've enjoyed. I thank you so much for watching. I'll see you again in a little bit when we see how the storm impacts things. Yeah. That's good for watching, folks. See you again in a bit.